Good evening, namaste, and welcome to this, the 47th edition of Guru Mantu, a series of 50 discussions with educationists and thinkers that's been happening every Saturday, 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. And the Guru Mantu talks are being organized by the Vivekananda Institute for Leadership Development, which is an initiative of the Swami Vivekananda Youth Movement. VLEAD itself is focused on developing human and social capital for the purpose of nation building, and it aims to do this by enhancing the potential of individuals and institutions across the development sector through engagement across four sectors, namely the government, NGOs, CSOs, corporates, or rather the MSMEs and the community. Guru Manthan is an initiative, a platform for teachers, particularly during this period of COVID when we've for share, discuss, debate. And we've had the who's who of people, who's who of speakers who have come and shared their thoughts as well as engaged with us on a variety of topics. As always, the format of the talk would be that the speaker would speak for about 25 minutes, followed by a moderated Q&A. Then the speaker would make the concluding remarks. Today, it's our pleasure and privilege to have with us Dr. Sridevi Annapurna Singh, Director, CSIR, of the CFTRI, the Central Food Technological Research Institute. Today she will be speaking on a very important topic, which is many studies have shown that, you know, nutrition is, or the right nutrition is closely connected to better cognition. And therefore that is the topic that she will be speaking about, particularly nutrition at the young age. So it's a pleasure to have you on board, ma'am. And the stage is yours.
Thank you very much. I thank the Vivekananda Institute for Leadership Development, which is a part of the Swami Vivekananda Youth Movement, for this opportunity given to me. I have always learned a lot, especially in school, from my teachers. In fact, whatever they said is probably the Veda mantra as compared to whatever parents or other elders say. And so I deem it a great privilege that I have this opportunity today to be speaking with many of the audience who I understand are teachers. So without much ado, I will share my presentation. Please bear with me. Is it visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Let us talk about nutrition and cognition today. Before I start, I thought, let me just tell you two small stories and then I talk about the brain and other things. So this is one lady who was born in June 1940. She was 20th child of her parents and born to a very poor Afro-American family. In fact, her mother used to be a housekeeper in many houses, and her name was Wilma Rudolph. I'm not sure if any of you have heard of her even, but she was born very early. She weighed only 2 kilograms. She had many illnesses when she was young, including pneumonia and scarlet fever. She even had polio, which damaged her left leg. In fact, she had to wear a brace even. Nevertheless, because of her large family who did all the massaging and gave her good food and exercising and all that, finally, she ended up being the first American woman to win 3 gold medals in one Olympics, that is in 1960. Just imagine the magic of the human body, how much it can overcome. And these were the words that she said after she won the medals, that my doctors told me I would never walk again, but my mother told me I would. I believed my mother. So this is the power of our belief and what are brave things and what we set out to do. It is really possible in the world. Another story that I would like to talk to you about is of Scott Hamilton. Now, he was born in 1958 and he was adopted at a very young age of 6 weeks in the USA. But at the age of 2, he contracted a very mysterious illness that kept his body from digesting food. And for the next 6 years, There were a series of unsuccessful treatments, but he never got better. In fact, all kinds of wrong diagnosis was also done. And finally, the Hamiltons, who were both professors, took their son to the Boston Children's Hospital, and where his ailment began to correct itself by a very special diet and moderate exercise. In fact, this physical activity, which is ice skating that the doctors advised, brought him a gold medal in 1984 for figure skating in the Olympics. So now I bring you to this marvelous machine that we call the human body. Just look at this wonderful machine that has been given to us free of cost. All of us have inherited it when we were born. And look at their organs. The liver can completely regenerate itself, even if it is lost around, even if 1% is remaining, it can regenerate itself. Our kidneys filter 1500 liters of blood every day. The heart pumps thousands of liters of blood every day. Our eyes can distinguish 10 million colors. Similarly, the stomach, our nose, our fingers, our bones, every single part of the human body, if you look at it, it is a marvel by itself. However, we do not take as much care of it as we would a new car or some other gadget that we buy. In fact, if you look at the message transmission, there is no computer which can do it as fast as our brain does even. And this body even can repair itself if we were able to keep calm and without stress and we sleep well. Then even the repair mechanism is activated in our body and it can rejuvenate itself. And all that we require to give it is food and oxygen, which is the fuel. So coming to nutrition, when you look at food, for the sake of nutrition, we generally divided it into macronutrients and micronutrients, which come from food. Apart from that, of course, there is water, because our body is made up of 70% of water. Macronutrients include the proteins, carbohydrates, and fats, whereas the micronutrients include vitamins and minerals. Now, food not only gives us energy, I'm going fast because I'm sure most of you are aware of this information. It's just to recapitulate that carbohydrates gives us energy, even fats do that. Some of the nutrients protect against infections like vitamin C. Then proteins are involved in bodybuilding. But food also has a very important role of satisfying hunger, which promotes psychological and social well-being. Generally, we take food sitting with our family and our friends, and this gives us a sense of comfort and well-being. So amongst each of our organs requires different nutrients. Not all the organs require all of it in the same kind of proportions. So you have, how do we get these nutrients is from the food that we eat, which could be in the form of staples like rice or wheat, or our pulses and beans, which generally are protein sources in India. Then the dairy products like milk and milk products, then fruits and vegetables. Apart from that, we also have a large array of meat, eggs, and fish. So when you look at the brain, it is considered the most complex organ in the body. It not only controls and coordinates the actions and reactions, but it also allows us to think and feel and enables us to have memories and feelings. All of these things that make us human and different from other animals. Although they also do have to a certain extent, but humans are more evolved in that sense. So cognition is that action or process of acquiring knowledge and understanding through thought, experience, and the senses. So when this process is working properly, then you are able to perceive and make judgments. Now, different parts of the brain are involved in different kinds of activities. maybe one part of the brain is involved in vision. There could be a part of the brain that is allowing you to process language and reasoning, problem solving, and so on. So all these skills are a part of cognition. It could even be social cognition, the way you interact with people in society, the way you execute your functions, how attentive you are, how well you understand, how well you are able to justify, listen, all of this are a part of cognition. So it includes all the conscious and unconscious processes by which knowledge is accumulated. And this could involve perception, recognition, conception, as well as reasoning. So learning itself is an example of cognition. The way our brain is able to connect to the different concepts that we are exposed to and remember what we have learned, build upon that, make a judgment and go forward in our life is all a part of cognition. And this reasonability and the way we use our logic is also a prime example of cognition. So this could be in terms of mathematics, it could be intrapersonal relation, how we relate to ourselves, how well we think about ourselves. Some of us feel that we are stupid, we are ugly. Everything is a part of cognition. Some of us are very good with musical talents, for example. Some of us are able to learn languages very easily and so on. Therefore, depending on the person, the kind of genetic background that they have inherited, as well as the environment that they are exposed to, people do have different ways of reasoning. Coming to the brain, it is really complex and it is a very, very, very wonderful organ. The different parts of the brain are involved in different aspects. Like I told you, the frontal lobe, for example, is involved in understanding and thinking and speaking and in memory as well as movement. Similarly, other parts of the brain are involved in different functions. So how do these, you also have a large number of cells, which we call as neurons, and which are involved in transmission of the different stimulus that our body is exposed to, maybe externally, maybe during the thinking. All of the these cells play a very, very important role. And there are neurotransmitters which are also involved in this message sending as well as receiving. So, food now, like I said, is a very, very integral part, and your diet is going to define how well you are able to process the information that you are exposed to, that you receive, and that you are able to transmit. And there are some foods which could, in the long term, harm your cognition. There are some foods which are going to actually help in cognition. Now, it is very important for me to tell you at this point that food is something which we eat on a daily basis, but the results of the what you are eating, you will not see immediately. It could happen after a few years. If there is a deficiency, for example, if that is not addressed, then it could result in a disease. So after 20 years, 30 years, maybe after 40 years, you start seeing the effects of what is the diet style that you have adopted. So, like I said, it is both hereditary as well as environmental, the brain capacity that we are having. And apart from the many factors that cognition is dependent on, nutrition plays a very, very important role. In children especially, the large part of structure and capacity is already determined by the age group. This is very, very important, and that is the reason why the mother and child nutrition is of utmost importance. What she eats is what the child is also going to be getting in terms of the inheritance of the brain capacity. So if she has been deficient and deprived of certain nutrients, then it is likely that the child also would be having the same issues. So there are certain nutrients which are identified for brain development in children. Some of them are listed over here, but it is not limited to only these. There are definitely many more which do play, and we are continuously trying to understand what is their role in cognition. So if you are having a very healthy nutrition, a balanced diet, what is known as per the age, gender and the kind of activity that a person is involved in, then you would be able to get the adequate micro and macronutrients at the appropriate time, and this would ensure smooth development of the brain. If it has been deprived, especially in the womb and at a very young age, there is every likelihood that the child could end up having mental retardation, behavior problems, and other problems. So I will talk about a few of these. One of the macronutrients that is very essential is proteins. All of us in our school have learned that proteins are required for growth and development. It is required for repair and so on. But what is this protein? Just look at this marvelous macromolecule. It is a polymer of what we call as amino acids. And these proteins are sequences of around 20 natural amino acids that are present in nature. Of this, around 8 of them are called as essential amino acids, which means that our body cannot make them and they have to come from our diet, the food that we eat every day. And if we do not get that in the right proportion, that means we are going to become deficient. Now, in India, at least, most of us are dependent on plant foods. We, even the so-called non-vegetarians, hardly have one or two meals in a week of animal foods. So generally, we are looking to get our nutrients from plant foods. And proteins, our sources are either dairy or legumes. Now, the problem is legumes are seeds of those plants, and they have been actually made by the plant so that its baby can survive on this mother earth and not as food or social activity to feed humans or animals. So these legumes are generally not having the kind of quality and the essential amino acid makeup what is required by humans. When you take off animal foods, what happens is the animal has already digested the plant food and it has remade the proteins to suit its body, which is very close to the needs of the human body, and therefore it is of better quality. Another thing is that seeds generally have what we call as anti-nutrients. This is made by the mother plant to prevent the seed from being consumed by either animals or by microflora or even by humans, so that the plant will get a chance to germinate and survive on this mother earth. And therefore, we need to cook it properly to destroy these anti-nutrients that will make it possible for us to digest it. And because of this reasons, menu diversity is extremely important. Eating only one kind of dal day on day, morning, afternoon, evening, night will always result in a deficiency, because whatever that legume is not having the essential amino acid, your body is not getting it. In this proteins, eggs and milk are always considered the highest quality protein, and that is the reason why children are generally given milk, and after weaning even egg is introduced to them. Vegetable proteins are considered lower quality. However, when we mix these legumes along with cereals, then you have a complete protein as per our needs. So why is it important? Now just look at this marvelous molecule called protein. You have protein which is actually involved in structure. Your hair is protein, nails are protein, skin has protein. All the enzymes in your body are made up of proteins. today we have the pandemic, all of us are afraid, the body has to build immunity, and that is done through the antibodies that are produced by our body whenever it is exposed to a foreign antigen. And these antibodies are protein. Proteins are involved in fluid balance. They are involved in transport. Any food that we eat is not generally coming directly into the blood, but it is carried by a protein called serum albumin and taken to different organs, and it goes into the cells. So it is very, very well programmed. So proteins have this nutritional function because all of this. So sometimes if you eat a protein which is deficient in methionine, for example, your hair would not grow well because methionine is required for hair growth. So if you are able to eat protein in a way that you meet all your body requirements on a daily basis of the essential amino acids, that is known as a complete protein. The non-essential amino acids can be made from these essential amino acids by the body. So like I already told, you require to eat a mix of proteins, and this because it is a body building, development and maintenance molecule, the brain also requires protein to a large extent, and it has to be of the right quality. Then omega fats. Most of us have this fad of not eating fat. But actually, when you look at fat, it is a very concentrated source of energy, and we do require it, especially when we are physically active. We have a lot of micronutrients like vitamins, which are not soluble in water, and they require fat to be solubilized so that our body is able to absorb this fat and make use of it. Otherwise, you need to only take pills, and they are not that good for the body. Fat also gives a very good taste to the food, and that is very important because when we enjoy our food, we tend to eat the right amounts. And especially with children, this is a very, very important factor to be considered. Now, coming to the brain, the brain is rich in lipids. All of us have heard of gray matter. Now, this gray matter is also having what we call the omega-3 fats. Now, omega-3 fats are something that we have seen in India, especially in our diet, it is very, very low, because these fats are made by algae, and they are stored in fish, especially in the liver. So when you eat fish, you are likely to get more of these omega-3 fats. Why are they important? They are, again, like proteins I told about essential amino acids. These are essential fatty acids. Our body cannot make them, and it has to come from the diet. Omega-6 and omega-3 both have to come from the diet itself. Omega-6 is present in plant foods. Omega-3 is only in animal foods, especially in fish. And the precursors of omega-3 are present in certain plant foods like chia seeds and flax seeds and walnuts. So if you look at the walnut, you will realize it looks like the brain. So nature is giving us a lot of hints as to what we should be eating as per the shape of the food also. These essential the fats are not destroyed throughout the life. So if we are able to give children at a very young age, they will retain this throughout their life. This is the last nutrient that will be, even in great starvation, it will not get destroyed by the body because it is so important for the brain. All the learning skills and language processing, etc., are dependent on omega fatty acids, especially omega-3. If there is an inadequacy, it can affect the neurodevelopmental disorders, attention deficiency, hyperactivity, and so on. All of this could result if there is an inadequacy of essential fatty acids. So depending on the age, depending on the gender, and so on, there are recommendations. Again, different agencies do recommend different amounts of these essential fatty acids. Now, coming back to the brain, zinc is another micronutrient, which is required very essentially for the brain. it is involved in neurogenesis, that is in the development of the brain, in the maturation and migration of the neurons. I showed you the picture of the neuron. So it is required even in synapse formation, and it is found in high concentration in synaptic vesicles. And therefore, it is involved in learning, memory, as well as reading skills. And its deficiency can result in reduced neuronal growth as well as brain volume and retardation of cognitive function. So if zinc is deficient, it can result in a very aggressive behavior as well as antisocial behavior, and reflect through poor learning, attention, as well as memory capacity. Many of the seafoods are known to be very rich in zinc, apart from red meat as well as many of the dry fruits. Iron is another very essential micronutrient. Many of us are aware of the role it plays in anemia, but it is also required in brain development. And we see that if you look at these two pictures, you can see how the neuron development is actually affected because of lack of iron. So if there is malnutrition, not only anemia, even brain development would be affected in the case of iron deficiency. And another fallout is on the social front. If the parents are at a disadvantaged economically, and they are also having deficiency of iron, which means the quality of interactions and the level of child involvement in the environment can all get affected. Vitamin B12 is required in very, very small quantities, but it is mainly present in animal foods, and to some very small extent, it is also made by our gut microbiota. We have around 90% of the in our body, you have 10 times more microflora than our own body cells. And many of them are known as what we call as probiotic. That means they help us to remain healthy, including having good immunity. And these microorganisms also are capable of giving us some amount of vitamin B12, especially if we are vegan. So this particular vitamin is involved in red blood cells formation, as well as the nervous system development, and especially in the spinal cord too. And if it is deficient, then it can result in degeneration of the nerves and impairment of the spinal cord. There are many symptoms. I have listed some of the sources of vitamin B12 over here. Then iodine is another micronutrient. We all know that it is involved in thyroid hormone secretion. It is required for development also, but these hormones do play a role in early development of the brain, and therefore that is also very, very important for cognitive performance. So vitamin B is another vitamin that is required. We do get it from sunlight, and there are other sources also, like fortified oils and milk. For example, once we get the vitamin into our body, then the liver and the kidney play a role in its change to active form, and then it plays a role in brain health. Then folic acid and choline. Again, folic acid is known to be given to pregnant women even in our country, but you should know that at least 3 to 4 children in every 1,000 children have this neural tube defect because of folic acid deficiency. So it has a very big role to play in the development of the spinal cord as well as the brain. And similarly, choline, it is there in the brain cells, especially in the membrane, and it is required not only for the cognitive function, but for performance in the sports as well as the health of other organs. So one very important thing I would like to specify here is the role of dry fruits and nuts. So we are all very fond of snacks. It is good to have snacks in the form of walnuts, almonds, or peanuts, because these are very rich in these micronutrients, especially the minerals that are required for cognition. That and also we need to make the right choices, and instead of having these unhealthy snacks, I will tell you in a minute why these are unhealthy, and to go more towards fruits and vegetables and other foods which are minimally processed, that are having all these nutrients in the right amount. Unfortunately, when you are deficient in micronutrients, often the effects are not seen till it manifests as a disease, and therefore it is known as hidden hunger. So your cells are hungry, but your body, your brain has not told you, and you keep eating the wrong kind of foods until you end up with a disease. So it is important to have a balanced diet with cereals, milk, pulses, fruits, vegetables, as well as animal foods in the right amount, as per the age and the gender and the kind of activity that we have. So I'm sure many of you are already following this, but make sure that you are eating a very diverse kind of a diet on a daily basis, and make sure that you have sufficient amount of protein in your breakfast. And after that, it has to be heavy also, and then it can be very, very lessened throughout the day, especially in the night, it can be very light. So these are foods that we all like, and they also have the nutrients like fats and protein and carbohydrates. So why are they not called food? Because many of these can lead to obesity, since they contain too much of fat, sugar and salt. And what happens when you become obese? The fat deposits around the organs in your body and does not allow them to function, and this results in damage and therefore in disease. It could be type 2 diabetes, it could be other kinds like cardiovascular disease and so on. And generally they manifest after the age of 40. So it is a result of around 20 to 30 years of bad dietary habits, and it is too late to turn back now. So that is the reason why they are known as junk food. And just being obese means that this fat is not really silent, but it is a very active fat, which is resulting in a lot of diseases like heart disease, diabetes, tooth decay, and even arthritis. And India, of course, is the diabetic capital, very soon to be, and the cardiovascular disease capital also. Plus, these foods have a lot of additives in them, which are added simply because they have to have a better shelf life. What chapati we make at home, by afternoon it becomes stale. But when you buy it, it is able to stay even for 7 days. That is why all these additives are added to it. And when these additives are going to your liver and other parts of your body, then there is a problem that is coming. It is only because we don't want to cook in the house freshly eaten food, and we are dependent on processed foods. So in children, it can result in mental fatigue, lack of concentration, headaches, dizziness. All of this, your body is telling you that I am not getting the nutrients that I require. Please listen to the body and understand and eat a balanced diet, because like I said in the very beginning, your body has come to you free, and until you lose a certain function, you will not realize how invaluable that was. No money can buy it back. So like I said, I just skip this. We use these additives because we want the food to remain safe and fresh and improve the quality, especially the sensory quality. So ultimately, we become what we eat. So if you want to be what you eat, please choose to be healthy and choose to be functional, choose to be productive to society. So apart from this, of course, good hygiene is required, and good deworming is required so that all your nutrients are absorbed. Then you require to drink sufficient amount of water. That is also very important. And this, especially since a lot of school teachers are here, I would like to stress that physical activity is of utmost importance in today's race of trying to get marks. Please don't deprive children of physical exercise. they need to run and play so that their brain will be healthy, and this exercise also releases happiness hormones, which is very, very important and helps them to learn, to think, to solve problems, to play in as a part of the team, which they will not understand, and when they grow up it becomes too late. So to enjoy an emotional balance and to contribute healthily to society, physical exercise is very important. And please realize that after the age of 16 to 17, children stop growing. So they need to be physically active at least till that age. Right, so this is just a summary. And since children are our future, it is absolutely essential for us to ensure that they are healthy and they are normal, and they have especially the cognitive function so that they are able to definitely contribute. What I have told you is not something very new. It has been known for thousands of years, even in our own country. And it has been told that one should not use food articles from either attachment or ignorance, but wholesome food should be eaten only after examination, because our body is a product of food. Please eat healthy, live happy, and stay safe. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think that was a very interesting take on food. And to start this off, I just had one question. We all seem to know that there is a fair amount of information on the need for nutrition, particularly in at a young age and all of that. But India continues to struggle with nutritional deficiencies across the board, particularly in children. That is one part of it. But we also see a great dichotomy. If you see in urban sectors, availability of food itself is not a problem. But what is being consumed is a big issue in terms of what children are consuming. They're not consuming nutritious food. They're consuming a lot of food. But in certain sections, you have the absolute deficiency of food itself, and then obviously nutrition itself. So what do you think is the issue here? Is it also because some parents have also been deprived of some food, comfort food, and therefore they're encouraging the children to eat like this, the multiple factors that if you could touch on in terms of why this happens?
Okay, if you look at our traditional food, what we call the thali, it was really diverse. The menu on it was absolutely wonderful, but it takes a large amount of time to actually prepare it. Today's world and generation, if you see, nobody wants to really spend that much time in the kitchen. Second thing is, if you look at our staples also, if you take rice, because in south of India, most of us eat a lot of rice. Initially, it used to be hand-pounded and you were getting the bran layers along with the rice, which was very healthy. The bran is also having a lot of fiber in it, and therefore, even when you eat a small quantity, you feel that satiety that I've eaten enough. But whenever there is pounded rice, what happens is within 15 days, it goes bad. It goes rancid. The smell will start coming, which says that people don't want to eat it. Now you want to go to a supermarket and you want to buy a year-old rice. So what has the processor done? They have removed all the healthy layers of the rice and only the starch is remaining on the grain. So what you are getting is only empty calories and no vitamins, no fiber, no minerals. So again, I don't know if I have to say, I don't know how many women are there in this forum, but I will take this opportunity to tell you also. Unfortunately, men have been kept out of the kitchen in our society. It could be that it was the identity of the women. They would not have an identity and therefore it was ruled by them. I don't know. I don't have the answers. But men generally don't participate in the nutrition of the family. Unfortunately, they hold even today the purse strings. So there is a disconnect as to what food should be eaten. The people who are having the knowledge are not able to dictate the terms. The people who make the food are not knowing what should be given to the family. especially in the rural areas. Fine. Suppose that were not the case also, what happens is availability of the raw materials has become a problem today. So I will tell you, you have to eat a fish, but you are somewhere inland, you are not getting the right amount or the right quality of that. Or maybe some other, if you are in a metro like Bangalore, probably you would be able to get and source many things. If I educate the mother, she knows that she has to give, but she is already having 3 children and she is unable to take care of the entire family, do the cooking, keep up the house. So in this process, many of the dishes which were a part of a traditional thali have been removed without really understanding the role that they played in our health. Finally, girls especially are married very young in our country, but the nutrition of the girl has not been given that kind of importance. So she is anemic, she is having calorie deficiency, she is having protein deficiency. Now she is becoming a mother. So I would like to stress over here, even be it a girl child who is born or a boy, what happens is, after, if you have been deprived in the womb, after the age of 40, there is scientific evidence to tell that you can end up with a lifestyle related disease like diabetes or cardiovascular disease. It has already been programmed in the womb of the mother. So please, at least today, let us give sufficient importance, as much, I'm not saying more, at least as much as for the boy child. If he is the Vamshodharaka, she is also the mother of the Vamshodharaka. So she requires that. And especially in families, what happens? She cooks everything and eats the leftovers. So many times the vegetable may be over, the green leafy vegetable may be over, and she is not going to restart cooking for herself. So she is not going to get all, even if she knows what is to be eaten, she is eating the leftovers. So please sit together on the family table and eat along with it. Please tell your mothers, your wives, your daughters that there is no need for them to serve and then eat the leftovers. Everybody should eat together. That helps. I hope I've answered at least partly. It is a very complex thing that you have asked, but
I just wanted to touch upon one more thing. You spoke about DHA and vitamin B12. I mean, other than algae, like you pointed out, it's not available in vegetarian food. And if you're vegan, you don't even have, you're further deprived. So that was one part of it. There are people, I know some people who opt for supplements that have DHA as well as, vitamin B12. So one part of it is your thoughts on that, but also about the availability, increasing availability. One of the things that happened as a result of the Green Revolution is the genetically modified food that has entered into India. So do you think that has also in fact reduced nutritional levels in our grains and other things? And also about the supplements that you would like to touch upon.
Okay, coming to vitamin B12, generally it is present, say, in fermented foods. For example, microorganisms are capable of producing it. So when you are having, say, an idli or something, a small quantity may be coming there, right? Apart from that, dairy foods like milk products also, you will get a small amount of vitamin B12. In the gut also, there is some reports. Still, science has to go forward to understand. There are some reports that vitamin B12 can be there. So fermented foods are a good source for vegetarians. Now, talking about what was the other thing you said?
I spoke about supplements in terms of
supplements. Generally, in supplements, what happens? There is a very high quantity of the micronutrient or macronutrient, whatever, depending on which supplement you are taking. They give 10 times, 100 times the dose what is required on a daily basis. Right? Say, for example, you are talking about vitamin A and D. There has to be some amount of fat in your diet for them to get absorbed. So if you deprive your diet completely of fat components, then your vitamins will not get, especially the fat soluble ones, will not get absorbed. I spoke about pulses where you are having these anti-nutrients. There are substances in seeds which are known as phytate. This phytic acid is capable of chelating with the minerals. So the reason why we see a lot of anemia, especially in India, is that we are getting our proteins only from these seeds. And these seeds are very rich. Even rice is having a lot of phytate, which will remove the calcium. It will make the iron not available for the body. So although I'm eating iron, although I'm eating calcium, I'm taking in zinc, because the phytate is a part of my diet, that will not allow it to get absorbed by the body and utilized. So it becomes supplements are one way, that way, which can actually, but too much of supplements is also not good. Especially when you talk about fat-soluble vitamins, for example, our liver is able to store it. So I don't need to have it on a daily basis. So when I take too much of it, sometimes there are problems of health that can come about because you have taken too much of these supplements too. But when you are in a deficiency, when the doctor has diagnosed it and they have prescribed it, it is good to take the supplement. But it has to be a very prudent kind of a judicious kind of a thing, not off the counter, go on taking supplements just because you read it on Google or something like that. Please remember that medical doctors have gone through a very rigorous training of more than 6 to 7 years to just get their MBBS, and then they have specialized. There must be some worth in that. So Google is not going to teach us what they have learned over several years. Coming to genetically modified foods, while there is no problem about nutrient content over there, there are some reports about allergens because of the kind of process that they undergo to produce these genetically modified foods. Especially in India, other than brinjal, we do not allow genetically modified foods. The law does not permit in our country. In other countries, it is allowed, especially soya bean or other things. They are doing a maize, but not in India, other than Georgia. Nutritionally, they are on par or sometimes even superior to the natural foods that are available. But there are certain reservations of the consumers as well as some scientists saying that they are having allergenic reactions and so on. We don't know. Time only is going to tell.
Thank you, ma'am. I have a couple of questions coming back to sort of to the topic. You did mention that malnourishment has been a big challenge in our country. The midday meal program that the government has rolled out try to address malnourishment as an issue along with attendance or enrollment as an issue. Where do you think we are with respect to addressing the malnourishment issue?
See, the government has defined protein and calories. They have not defined any other things. Now your cells, like I said, your brain requires certain nutrients. Maybe it requires more amount of zinc as compared to other organs. Right, your pancreas requires zinc. Maybe your liver requires something else. Your heart may require omega-3 fatty acids. Now, to get all of this on a daily basis, you have to have menu diversity. Just giving rice and sambar is not going to give you all the micronutrients that your body requires. Now, please remember, the body metabolism is in a very fine balance. Everything, if it is perfect, your body works perfectly. Your cell is asking for protein, you are giving it fat. Your cell is asking for iron, you give it selenium. Your cells are asking for some other, maybe vitamin A, and you go and dump vitamin C on it. How is it going to do that? You know, some of these are coenzymes, for example. For another enzyme to act, it is essential. Maybe zinc is essential. Maybe folic acid is essential, but you're not giving folic acid. Therefore, though that enzyme is there, it is not able to act. Because that is not able to act, some other reaction doesn't take place. Because that reaction does not take place, some other thing happens. And ultimately, it results and manifests in terms of poor learning, poor recognition, mental retardation, and so on and so forth. So now, why is this happening? The government has excellent intentions. Believe me, I have seen many Anganwadis. They are doing a marvelous job and for very little money. The thing is, per child, given the kind of population that the government aims to feed, the amount of money that is allocated per child is a problem. So if they say 7 rupees 20 paisa, in 7 rupees 20 paisa, even buying rice at 1 rupee per kg, you are only able to do so much. And especially children in the lower socioeconomic strata do require a lot of fat. They are calorie deficient. They are protein deficient. Calories means money. You go and try to buy a liter of fat, you will know that less than 150 rupees per liter, you cannot get oil. So how does the government give fat to the child? So if we have to give a balanced diet, then we have to think of a different kind of a strategy, look for alternate. Also, the Supreme Court has said that we have to give traditional food. So in the south of India, we give rice and sambar. In north of India, you give chapati and dal and thing. So a child is only having a very limited appetite. You say 400 grams of rice it has to eat to get that calories. Can the child really eat 400 grams? Excuse me. It's not possible. So that energy dense food has to be given, that even if it is able to eat 25 grams, you know, some portion of the daily requirement is met. So there is a need to make some foods which are energy dense, protein dense, and which are fortified with these micronutrients, which is what CFTRA has done. But they are not really in the traditional manner what we know about, like rice and sambar, for example. That also the government is now thinking of bringing in fortified rice kernels for the midday meal program. So they want to fortify it with iron. But like I said, it also depends on the child, how much they're able to absorb, how much they're able to assimilate. Because rice is also rich in phytate. So you are putting iron there, it will chelate it, how much of it will actually become bioavailable. All that needs to be worked out. But definitely over a period of time, it has improved. That stark poverty, what used to be there, does not exist anymore. Only thing is, we are a growing population. So the benefits of the program is not really being seen because of the large number of population which is getting added on year.
As a follow-up question, ma'am, if there is a child who has not received sufficient nourishment for brain development, especially in the formative years, is this deficiency reversible later?
Up to the age of 3, the brain is developing. So from the womb till maximum 5 years of age, the brain is developing and the child is going to get the gray matter, whatever is there, apart from the genetic inheritance. Beyond that, it is not repairable. I'm sorry, it is irreversible. That is where nutrition becomes a really a very huge issue. And even two parents and two grandparents or four grandparents are not sufficient. We have to invest. In spite of all this, let me tell you, Indians are some of the brainiest in the world. It is not as if we have very stupid people or something. No, our children are extremely intelligent. So there are many things that we have still not understood about omega-3 fatty acids also, that even though we are pakka vegetarians, how is it that our brain is still getting it? And it is there in our body. So there may be still a mechanism by which it is assimilating. But this is where traditions become very important. We have just thrown them on the roadside depending on convenience. But many times, you know, it was passed on from generation to generation that when a child was born, the mother was given certain foods. you know, rich in flaxseed, for example, or rich in, you know, this acacia, because there is a tendency, the gut has to come back to normal. So a lot of fiber needs to be given. Now, why is fiber important? Because this fiber is not digested in our body. We do not have the capability or the enzymes to digest. But the microorganisms which are residing in our gut use that as food. And so you are able to get the good microbiome in your gut. And that microbiome will also help to produce this short chain fatty acids as a result of digesting this fiber, which helps in your immunity. No, the world was wondering how Indians are so immune, even though they are so dirty, there's no hygiene in this pandemic. But probably our eating habits, which has come over generations, has helped to a large extent also in protecting us. At the same time, we need to recognize the importance of this and retain them. We cannot just discard certain practices and should not be also averse to adopting certain other practices from the outside, so that we are a healthy nation, which is even behavior wise also we have to be healthy. Socially, we have to be responsible. Everything is important. So learning is only one part of a very, very small drop in the ocean to which makes a wholesome individual in this society, as per my understanding.
Thank you. There's one more question in the chat box. I'll club it with another question. Of late, we see that new items are sort of added to our menu, like spirulina is an example. How important is it to add such components to our diet, or is it okay if we don't add as well?
See, spirulina is a blue-green algae. Like I said, omega-3 fatty acids, the cardiovascular problem in India is very, very huge. We are the world number one in cardiovascular disease, right? The omega-6 to omega-3 fats, what we eat, that ratio is understood to be very important. So you have what we call a saturated fat. You have butter and ghee and coconut oil. These are generally palm oil. These are saturated fats. Then you have monounsaturated fats, like olive oil, for example. Then you have polyunsaturated fats, like sunflower oil, for example. Now, this ratio has to be 1:1:1, or even 1:2:1. Okay, then we say it is a healthy fat diet. Omega-6 to omega-3 ratio has to be something like 5:1, ideally. Up to 10:1 is okay. In India, you have pockets where it is 50:1. So you have this huge population which is eating very unhealthy fat. Now, one source of omega-3 fatty acid is spirulina. Like I said, in the sea, the algae and all make it, and then the fish eat the algae and it gets stored in its liver. So this omega-3 fats, this DHA and EPA, what is very important for brain development, especially in very young children, as well as in the elderly, because they also start experiencing memory loss and, you know, get into Alzheimer's, Parkinson's disease and all this. So there also, this omega-3 fat becomes a very important nutrient, even for heart. So some of these unusual sources of food are unusual sources of nutrients in our diet. So it could be a good idea. The problem with spirulina is none of us like the taste. It is very untraditional to our palate. Whereas the Japanese eat a lot of seafood, so they like these kind of things. But we have recently developed a product which is known as chikki, which is a traditional sweet, but we have added spirulina to it. So maybe the addition of spirulina to some of our traditional dishes, which are maybe very spicy also, would mask that taste, so that you are able to get the nutrients without having to feel bad about eating that food.
on a lighter note.
Think about it. I just want to make a last comment. You know, we spend so many thousands of rupees on cosmetics, shampoos and all that. But how many of us even say thank you to our liver or to our heart or to our brain for working the way it does without complaining? Even if even they even repair themselves, you don't need. Whereas the amount of time we spend on our cars, you know, morning you get up and try to shine it, buy wax for it and so on. Let us at least give what it is asking for. That's all. I'm not saying that, you know, you have to go out of the way, but please be thankful for the body that we have got at birth and which is trying its best to remain healthy under the most adverse circumstances, be it pathogens, be it pollution, be it stress, you know, all of this. In spite of that, it is still trying to give us a good quality life. Please realize its worth. So remain happy and be thankful. That itself will help your body to work well.
We are running out of time. So one last question.
Sorry, I tend to talk too much. Okay.
I should say enlightening answers. One last question before we move to Ramesh. On behalf of all the teachers in the audience, we have seen a lot of lifestyle-related illnesses among teachers also. So nutrition and cognition, not just of students, but even of teachers is important. So any quick comments on what is happening with respect to diets and what should be done?
See, all of us have changed our diet. Like I said earlier, the women have started working, especially in urban areas. So there is very limited time. Our travel time to the workplace has also increased tremendously, especially in the metros. All of this has contributed to us depending on processed foods on the one hand, removing a lot of things, packing. You know, I make breakfast, I pack the same thing for lunch, I come back and eat the leftovers in the evening. So you are having a very monotonous kind of a diet. The stress of travel, the stress of interacting with people, sometimes they may not be as accommodative to you because they are also stressed out. Not spending enough time with yourself to understand what your body requires, what your mind requires. How many of us, when we go back in the evening, including me, I am not exempting myself also, just have a look around your living room. Everybody is looking at their mobiles. Nobody is even looking at each other. Forget about talking. So it is important that the family should spend some amount of time at the dinner table trying to discuss. This emotional well-being is very finely connected to the diet. So whatever food you are eating and when you're sharing it with the people you love is going to go a long way in your cognition and health. And the next day you are better rejuvenated to, you know, address your students this way. Please don't think of the classroom as a means of going to the next level. I do guide a lot of PhD students and I see this disconnect. Something they have learned is for the examination. It is not for their daily life. But you have to adapt it. When I am saying trigonometry, it is not only for writing the examination. It is the way you place your beaker on your workbench also you can utilize it. Many students who are very good in maths, you will find when you go to their houses, their cupboards are very well organized. You know, there is organization of thinking, of logic, of reasoning. So the teachers need to approach their teaching to the students in that way rather than to just finish off a syllabus. When you finish a syllabus, the student also finishes and forgets about it after the exam is over. But that is not going to carry them through life. Some point in time, we are going to pay a price for it. As a country, as a society, as a family, as an individual, on all of this we will. So it is very important that we connect all the dots and give our children the right kind of education.
Thank you.
Food and nutrition.
Yeah. As you you could go to concluding remarks. In that, I just wanted, if you could just touch upon one aspect. You spoke about essential amino acids. And, you know, for a short period, soya protein was considered to be an essential, has all nine amino acids and all of that. But then now the reports are also, you know, quite controversial in terms of whether soya is good, bad, and all that. If you could touch that as well as part of your concluding remarks.
You're talking about the last 20 years of my life. I have been working on soybean.
Oh, okay.
Right. Soybean is having around 40% protein. Okay. It is an excellent source of protein. Now, if you remove the fat, fat is around 19%. So, when you remove that oil part, it will go up to 50% of protein in the flour. For adults, it is as good as milk or eggs. For adults, because soya bean is a plant source of protein, there are many anti-nutrients in it. So when you are thinking about a child who is in a very active phase of growing, then what happens is sometimes the body is not able to assimilate all the what is being eaten. Right? Having said that, soya bean is a complete protein, closest to milk and eggs. It is having certain minor components in it which mimic our human estrogen. And therefore, there are some issues that people tell, which is not really completely validated scientifically, that girls are attaining puberty much earlier than before. The fact is, earlier girls were not getting as much protein as today they are, because the parents are more affluent and you know, living in the urban society, they are getting better nutrition. So that may be a cause. It is not necessarily because of soya. So soya is definitely a very good source of protein. It is 50% protein after you have removed the oil. So that way it is a healthy protein also. But and because the machines are available, imported from outside, you are able to very hygienically process it. And CFGRA has developed processes for making the concentrate where you remove these anti-nutrients from it so that the body can better manage the protein. It is very rich in phytate, it is very rich in tannins, it is having a lot of other, you know, trypsin inhibitors. Now, these are substances which will not allow the enzymes in your body to work. It will inhibit them. So, the protein does not get digested. You have eaten the protein, it does not get digested, it is removed from the body. So, these are the problems with plant foods. But at the same time, and one more thing I would like to tell here is the age group of 2 to 5 years is the most demanding group. These children. So any protein that meets their requirement, you can essentially say it meets the requirement of all human beings, of all age groups. So this is called the PDCAS value, protein digestibility corrected amino acid score. And that is what is today being used. And therefore, adults, again, I repeat, for adults, soybean is equal to milk and eggs. For children, probably milk is the best. Please make them understand they need to have milk. And don't club it along with cereals and all that. Because like I said, this phytate and all will come, so the calcium will not get absorbed. So traditionally, as soon as they get up, we have been giving them a glass of milk. Continue to do that. Before they go to bed, give a glass of milk. So there is sufficient time that has happened for them that these nutrients become better available.
Thank you very much, ma'am. I think this was a wonderful session, I think, in terms of what you covered, because it's not often that you know, teachers get to speak about nutrition even within the classrooms. I must also take this opportunity to remind all of our participants. I think we spoke about it last time. You could send your, if you have any short videos or how you've used, you know, much of the learning that's come out of this Guru Manthan, the last few series. If you have anything, please share on the numbers that are there on the chat box, either to the WhatsApp or through email. Please do that. And like I said, you know, we as we come to the last final leg, the last sprint of the final leg of the Guru Mantra. And again, like I said, ma'am, thank you very much for taking time out and sharing your thoughts on nutrition and its critical role in cognition and child growth, as well as its importance in adults. Thank you very much. Also, thank you to all the participants who have continued to come and, you know, kept us going. Thank you very much and look forward to meeting all of you again next week.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.